Hi, this is Comp 1010 at the University of Manitoba. I'm Dr. Celine LaTulip, and today I'm going to be talking to you about creating functions that can take parameters. So, subprograms are an important idea in computer science. A modern piece of software, something like Microsoft Word or the Fortnite game or even something like Discord on the web, contains thousands and thousands of program statements, maybe millions. And you can't really reasonably write this as one long single program, line after line after line. It would be completely unmanageable. So even smaller apps, things that are not as complicated as those, are written as little collections of what we call modules or subprograms. So we often talk about modularizing a program, breaking it up into small pieces that do one little bit of the problem. And the names for this type of thing are many. So subprograms, subroutines, functions, procedures, modules, methods, predicates. There's many different terms. In processing, we call these subprograms functions. That's the term we use. In Java, you should know that they're called methods. So what functions allow is a lot of different things. So one thing with functions is that you can have one programmer write a really large program, but do it a little bit at a time. Another thing is that you can have multiple programmers write different parts of a program by having them each write different functions. And then you can create libraries of functions that can be used by other people. So the processing library has a bunch of built-in functions that you've already been making use of. Java has many different libraries that you can import and make use of, or built-in libraries of functions as well. So when we add parameters to function, that actually doubles our power. It allows us to send in some information that can be used to do things slightly differently each time the function is called. And that ends up being very powerful. So we can draw a circle if we don't have any parameters, but we could draw a circle of a given size and color at a given location with a given stroke weight, that type of thing, if we create different functions that take pieces of information as parameters. So you can think of functions as being sort of a block or a black box. And so there are parts of functions that are seen by people who just use the function. And then there's the parts of functions that you as the person creating the function see. So let's talk about the first. What does someone who wants to use a function need to know about it? They need to know what data the function needs to be given. In this example, it needs to be given two different ints. And they need to know the name of the function so that they can call it. In this case, it's get%. And then they need to know if this function is going to give anything back. In this case, this function is going to give back a float, which is the percentage value. So that's the type of the answer that's returned. So every function has a name. Lots of functions have data items they accept. And it's important to note that those data items have specific types. So you can't just pass in anything. You've got to pass in information that matches the type required. And sometimes there's a type of data that the function gives back as a result. And in this case, it's float. But in some cases, there isn't anything returned. And in that case, we use the special keyword void. So the name and the types form what we call the signature of the function. And that looks like this. So float get% int int. That's what somebody who wants to use this function needs to know. They need to know the name, what the different types and how many pieces of data need to be passed in. In this case, it's two ints need to be passed in, and what type is going to be returned so that they can create a variable of that type to receive that value. So this means we're going to call get%, we're going to send in two int data items, and it's going to send us back a float data item. And as I said before, some functions don't send anything back, and in that case, we use void as the return type instead of something like float or int or string. So when you want to create a function that takes parameters, you need to figure out what parameters you need, what their types are, and then you also need to give them local names or local identifiers. So here's an example of us starting to think about creating a function. It's going to not return anything. It's just going to draw some stuff on screen. So the return type is void. This is the name of the function, draw random size ball. And this is going to take five parameters. So the parameter is a type here and a local variable name that we'll use inside the function. So float x, float y. So this is basically two parameters that tell us where we're going to draw the ball. And then three parameters, which are ints, red, green, and blue. And these are three parameters we're going to use to set the color of the ball when we draw it. And then here's the body, and we're not showing what's in the body of this function. So five pieces of information: name, the parameter types, so float, float, int, int, and int, and the return type. So these things that are in red are things that the user of the function needs to know. And then there's the local identifiers, x, y, red, green, and blue. And these are basically, you can think of them as local variable names that will be used inside the function. And then there's the body. So the stuff that's pointed to here with the purple, that's stuff that only the person who's writing the function needs to know about and think about. So the red items form what we call the signature. And that's what someone who wants to use your function will look at. So the signature for this function up here looks like this. Oops, that should be a void. That's a mistake. So let me correct that. Pen void. So void, draw random size ball, float, float, int, int, int. These local variable names, the user of the function doesn't need to know about them. They're never going to try to use them, and they shouldn't try to use them. They don't even need to know what they are. As the programmer who's creating the function, that's you, you need to specify names, because somebody's going to pass information in. They're going to pass you a float. You're going to have something that you store it in. So there's going to be a local variable automatically created, and it's going to be called this, whatever you decide that should be. And then you'll be able to get the data that's passed in by using this name, because you don't know what they're passing into you. You don't know where it's stored or anything. And then you, as the person who's creating the function, you need to write the body, the code of the function, and reference these local identifiers, these local variable names. So this picture depicts what's created. So if this is the function, which is the one we've just been doing, and someone calls your function by doing something like this, they call it with width divided by 2, height divided by 5, 255, 0, and 0. Inside of your function, these five local variables get automatically created. You do not create them. They get automatically created by the compiler, and the information that's passed in gets stored in them. So let's assume that this is a canvas size of 500. If someone calls this, draw random size ball, width over 2, that's 250, that's an int. It gets passed in, and we have a local variable. It's a float variable, it's called x, that 250 gets stored in it. It gets automatically casted from an int to a float, and it's stored as 250.0. Similarly, if we have height divided by 5, that'll pass in 100, that gets stored in here as 100.0. These three are passed in, they are ints, and they're passed into ints, and they get stored here. So these variables only exist while the function is called and operating, and as soon as the function is finished, everything here will just disappear. So these variable values then can be used. So now we're seeing what the body of this function looks like. So here's void draw random size ball with our parameters. And inside this function, we're creating a local variable called diam. We're getting a random number, which is related to the width of the canvas. That's how big the ball will be. And then we're calling fill, and we're calling it with red, green, and blue. These are our local identifiers. And we're getting these values out that were passed in by the user who called the function and setting the fill color. And then these numbers that were passed in by the user who called the function are being used to, in the ellipse call, to specify where the circle or the ball is going to be. Okay, so that's what's happening when somebody calls your function. And then this is flexible because you can call it with things like this, width over 2, height over 2, 255, 0, 0. You could call it with something like this. If this function call was inside of a nested for loop and we had values of I and values of j, we could call this over and over again. So let's assume I is 2 right now and j is 3. This is then going to store different values in here. So we'd have 20 in float x, actually that would be 20.0, and 60.0 in float y, 200 in red, 0 in green, 100 in blue. And now this function is still drawing a random size ball, but it's drawing it in a different place and with a different color because that information is being passed in from the user. Here's another example. We could call this with the value 200, and we could reference some other variable that's somewhere else in our program, a global variable called location y, for instance, and then pass in 0. We can put expressions in here when we call these parameters, like rand of 255. And so these values then get stored. So again, 200 gets converted to a float. We have 200.0. Location y must be 325. It gets put in here. 0, and then we get some value from random. That's, let's assume it's 177, and then 100. So now we're going to draw a differently colored ball at a different location. What's really important to note with this specific example is this idea of there being a value in a variable somewhere else in the program. So this variable is location y. It's an int variable. It's got this number in it. When this function call happens, these numbers get put into these local variables and used, and that's all great. What's important to note is that this here gets copied into here. So if we make a change to any of these local variables that are automatically created by the compiler based on the names that we've given here, if changes are made to any of these, they don't affect things like this where the value was passed in from. So let's look at what that looks like. Imagine there was another line of code right here. This makes no sense. There's no reason to have this line of code right here. It doesn't really do anything. But if we assigned 3.0 to y, that would change this value of this local variable. It does not change the value of the variable where that value originally came from. And so at the end, after we've drawn this ball and we're done with this function, what happens is all of that stuff disappears. And this local variable up here where that data was originally copied from, that 325 value, it is unchanged. So just always remember that values are copied from other variables. When you use variable names in a function call, the value is retrieved from that variable and copied into these local variables that are created in the function. So another thing to think about is, what does the execution flow look like? So as soon as the compiler finishes the executing the function, local variables will disappear. But what is the order of all this? So when we get to this line, we have a function call, and that means execution jumps. We don't execute whatever is down here below. We jump to this function, and variables are created. The values are stored in those local variables. Those variables are used as we execute the body of this function, and then when we're done, the variables disappear and we jump back, and now we're ready to execute whatever line of code comes next. So that's how the execution flow works. So just to look at a couple of quick examples, here's a function that is written to display a game over message, and we've got parameters passed in which specify the color for the text of that message. So this isn't returning anything, but we are passing in red, green, and blue, R, G, and B. This time we've used these names. And it's up to who the person writing the function to decide what names to put in here, because they're the ones who are going to be using them in writing the body of the function. So here we're using the R, G, and B values to set the fill color. We are creating the string message, and then we're using the text to actually display this to the screen, and we're displaying it kind of in the middle of the screen, basically. So if you wanted to call this from your draw function, you use the name, and then you have to pass in three ints because that's what this function requires. So you might pass in these, and that would generate a lime green message, and that would end up looking like this. All right, one more example. Here I've created a function called pumpkin. And this is just to show you a little bit more of like the power of functions. So I've got a bunch of drawing calls here that define you know, sort of a little graphic image of a pumpkin. I've set the color to orange. I've got an ellipse for the basic, you know, circle of the pumpkin. And then I'm setting the fill color to black. And I'm drawing some triangles for the eyes and sort of the nose. So what's being passed into this function is X and Y, which are the location, that's where I'm going to draw the pumpkin, and diam, which is just how big the pumpkin is. And so X and Y are used throughout these drawing calls to draw eyes and the nose relative to where the pumpkin is, and relative to the size of the pumpkin, because diam is used throughout here. So in my draw function, I have a for loop, and I'm calling pumpkin, and I'm giving it random width and random height and some and a random size between 20 and 100 for the diameter of the pumpkin. I'm going to call this 10 times every time the draw function happens, which is 60 times a second. So this is going to draw a ton of pumpkins at random locations and of random sizes. And we can look and see what this looks like. So tons and tons of pumpkins, 10 new pumpkins every 60th of a second, and that's just the video stopping. So this would go on forever, drawing just bazillions of pumpkins. And so just this one function with, you know, what, 8 lines of code in here or 6 lines of code is responsible for doing a whole lot of drawing, and it's drawing pumpkins that are differently sized and differently located each time. So that's sort of the power of being able to pass in different pieces of information and allow this one function to do lots of different things. Okay, so that's it for thinking about functions that take parameters and how you create those and then make use of the parameters in your function body. Thanks for watching.